Okay. So last week we had stopped at variables, right? We have seen how to create Python variables, right? Do you guys remember where did we stop last week? Guys, are you guys there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
You taught us the binary and how to convert I forgot the
Yeah,
name, is
so
it?
last week we have learned a lot of things, right? So we have learned about the number system, we have learned about algorithm, we have learned about the flow charts and all that stuff. And if you guys remember, you were supposed to take some homework. How many of you have done the homework converting the number systems from one format to the other format? Who has completed it? Or no one even bothered to do it? Anyone? See, some of these things, right? It's very important that you take it seriously. Otherwise, it's of no use just wasting your and my time, right? So it's good that we learn everything seriously. So hardly it should take an hour for you to just do this homework, right? So you should be able to find an hour in the entire week and do some of these things, okay? Great. So do you guys remember what is the variable used for and why do we need variables? So basically, variables are like boxes which can hold values in the programming language. So basically, the way how we have seen your mom tries to hold everything in containers in your kitchen. So similarly, in programming languages, we use variables to hold the values. And we have seen what are the syntax or semantics for creating variables, saying that hey, it should not start with a number, it should only start with characters and underscore, right? And we also said like it should not have spaces, and then we should not use Python keywords sort of thing. Okay, now let's get into a little bit more understanding the strings. So strings is nothing but it's a sequence of characters, a series of characters. So in any programming language, especially Python, you can store different types of values in a variable. So you can store numbers, you can store strings, you can store, say for example, Boolean values. So strings are nothing but it's just a text series of characters which you can use it for any programming purposes. So in Python, you can use double quotes or single quotes. Both of them are valid strings. Let's see a quick example of what does that mean. Say for example, what we meant was like say there is a message, we can use double quotes, hello, I am a string, and say print. Let's see what happens, message. Okay, if you see, what's wrong? No such file or directory. Okay. Maybe something went wrong with my build. Let's see. Okay. Yeah. Now it came back. Maybe it forgot the build system. So if you see, I can do the same thing with single quote as well. Let's say message two. And instead of double quotes, I'll say, hello, I'm a different string. Okay, and I could just print the same thing. Cancel. If you see, you see the difference. I could either use a double quote or a single quote to construct a string variable. So there are a lot of uses of strings in programming language. You can store text, you can store paragraphs, you can store names, and a few other things where you need to use in programming languages. So there are a few important things what you would like to use in your programming language day-to-day usage. So I will not go through each and every functions what the strings or we can use it on strings. So basic things, say for example, if I have everything in small, let's say I am a string in small cases. Okay, so if you see here, everything is a small case. So let's remove this. Let's say there is a string which is being printed here. If you see, I am a string in small cases. Say every string variable, we can apply some functions or you can apply some methods. Let's see what are there. Let's say there is a function called title. So when you apply this, all the words, the first character of the words will be converted into capital. If you see, all the first character of the words are being converted into capital. This is also sometimes called as camel case. So there are a lot of functions which you can use on string variables. So title is one of them. If you see, you can use another function called upper. If you see here, everything is getting converted into uppercase. Say, for example, if I want to convert everything into lowercase, right? Let's say I say there are a few words which are there in uppercases and I want to convert it to lowercase. So I can definitely use some of these functions. See, every character is getting converted into lowercase. Say, for example, if there are a lot of spaces in the string, let's assume there are a lot of spaces at the beginning or at the end. Let's say if I have to remove spaces on the left, I use, say, strip, left stripped. You see, all the space is being removed. If I don't use this, the space will be printed as is. See here, the difference. If I use, say, for example, R strip. Okay. Basically, it will remove the right side space. If you just use another function which is there, okay, it removes spaces on both sides. Functions or methods are nothing but just utilities which are being provided by Python inbuilt so that we can use them. Okay, so there are a lot of functions like what you can use, but I have just given you some useful functions which you can use. Okay, so let's also see something called fstrings, which is available in Python 3.5 and above version. Say, for example, if you have something like this, let's say I have a variable called, let's take some variables. Let's say first name. Okay. Let's say Madan, and let's say last name, another variable I'm declaring or creating to store Mohan. Let's say now I wanted to print, okay, both the names. Okay, let's say I wanted to print and I wanted to also print something else here. Let's say hello, my name is. How do I use first name and last name here? We can print those values, okay, by using flower brackets, first name and last name, like this.
Sir?
Yep.
So for that, we have to add F at the starting, right?
Yes, I'm adding, okay? So if you, I'm just showing first, okay? If you see this, it is just printing as it is. It is not interpreting as the value from that variables, okay? So if we have to actually print the value, then you have to add F. That is called F strings in Python. If you add a F character in front of the string, then it evaluates the value which is being provided in the flower brackets. Now, if you see, it is printing, hello, my name is Madan Mohan. If you see here, it is taking the value which is in the variable first name and also in the last name. Then it is printing the value of it because I have used a F string. That is the difference. So in F string, the string values will be evaluated and printed. Okay. That's one useful thing what you would need. So there are a lot of things you can do using the F strings. So basically, we can also use functions within F strings. Say, for example, let's say I wanted to use a function called upper within the string. Say here, let's see what happens. See, the Mohan is converted into upper. Let's say Madan, I wanted to convert it to lower, okay, like this, okay. So this one is getting converted into lower, okay. You can do some of these things like this, okay. So these are all called F string variables, okay. Now let's say if you wanted to add some tab or new line in the string, let's say I wanted to, if there is a long text or a long paragraph, something like this, okay. Let's say there is a long paragraph, something like this, okay. Something like this. See, there is a long paragraph. Just assume if I wanted to create a new line here, I do is backward slash n is the special character for new line. So if you run now, wherever you have included this new line character, the string will be split into multiple lines. Say for example, if you add more at the beginning, let's say what happens if I can add any number of new lines. See, it has printed so many empty spaces in the beginning. I can add anywhere I want. It would be treated as new line. Okay. That is one thing. Similarly, you can also add a tab character. So the tab character is backward slash T. Okay. Say, for example, if I wanted to add tab in between. Okay. I can do that. See, there is a tab character which is being printed. There is a space, okay? So these are some of the useful things what you would come across, or sometimes it would be required for you to use in the programming. We have already seen the L strip, R strip, strip. L strip is for removing left side spaces. R strip is for removing right side. Strip is for both, okay? Great. Now we have seen variables. Now let's briefly play around with the numbers. Okay, so in Python you can store any type of variable. Let's say you can store a numeric integer, you can store floats, or you can store constants also. Let's see what happens. Okay, if I just say 2 by 2 plus 2, nothing happens. Okay. So I have to print. Let's say print 2 plus 2. It just prints 4. Okay. Let's say if I say 2 into 2, it just prints 2. The same thing if I use a float, the value changes. Whenever there is a float in the arithmetic operation, the result will also be in a float or in a decimal. See, the same thing. The moment I change this into a decimal value, it will print it in the decimal. So there are so many things you can do. Just I have shown you plus and say multiplication. You could do similarly subtraction. You know how to do subtraction, right? So just use 20 minus 10. So basically these are all some of the operators what we have got. And similarly, you could do division is forward slash, right? So basically, if you see, this is the division what it has done. So similarly, you could do all sorts of things. So the percentage is used for the remainder thing. Okay. So similarly, you could use a lot of things. Say for example, if you wanted to do a exponential. Okay, let's do 2 exponential of 2. Any guesses what would happen? 2 star star 2, this is used to refer exponential.
So it will be 4.
Exactly. If I say 3, what will happen?
8.
Exactly. So basically you could use 2 stars for representing the exponential symbol. Okay. Or exponential operator in Python. Okay. Every language would have its own meaning and purpose. So you would have 2 stars in Python. Let's say I have to do something like this. Okay. I'm using multiple operators here. But say, for example, if I wanted to give precedence, okay, first, which operator should be executing, then I can use the brackets. Okay, then this will operate first and say, and then left to right, this will operate first, and then there will be a multiplication which is being provided. So 2 plus 2 is 4, and say multiplied by 2 divided by 2 is 1. So 4 into 1, the answer is 4. So you can group certain operators into like brackets and give importance or precedence that it should be executed fast. Okay, are we clear with all the operators what we can perform?
Yes, sir.
In basic ones? Okay. So basically, as we have seen, any float value would result in the float outcome. Say for example, if you have 1 plus 1, what will be the output type? Integer. The moment you have any float, the output also will be in integer, right? So that is what we have already seen here. Okay, so one interesting thing, say for example, if you have a very large number, so in Python you can also use underscore. Say for example, let's use a number. Let's say there is a number which I am, say, large number. Let's say large number. Okay, let's say something like this. It's very difficult to read, right? You don't know what is this, what value it is, right? It is very difficult to read. So for us to make it easier, Python also helps you to use underscores in the numbers. Say for example, if I wanted to use like, say, underscore, say 10,90,000. Okay, so that it helps me. Okay, see, I can use it, provides a readability. So this is also a valid number in Python. You can use underscores, but not spaces. Okay, this will break, this will throw error. Okay, so underscore is a valid number in Python. So if you come across programs like this, so you can say this is a safe option to use. So we have seen, say for example, we have created a lot of variables, right? Like say variable 1, variable 2, variable 3, right? So sometimes it might be easier if you do all these things in one line. So Python also offers you something like this. You can also use this syntax. Okay, this is a valid syntax. Okay, that's what you would see in Python sometimes, people using it this way also. Okay, see, it has assigned 1 to v1, 2 to v3, and so on. So you can use this single line notation as well, so that you can avoid some space, or you can just avoid doing it in multiple lines. Okay, clear? Okay, so there is a convention in Python. Whenever you see a variable which is there in caps, okay, that means it is a constant, it is a convention. Okay, say for example, if I see say conversion rate INR to, what is the conversion rate? Okay, say conversion rate, like say 74 rupees. So this becomes a constant. Okay, see, you can use conventions to create variables. Okay, so in Python, say for example, you wanted to create some comments. Comments are a useful thing, and whenever you wanted to write something, okay, what this means in program itself, you can use comments in Python. This variable is used to convert, okay, USD to INR. Okay, like this. Okay, great. So let's quickly jump on to some quiz. Okay, let's open this. Where are these? Okay, great. So let's pick. So what functions did we see, Meenakshi, on string? What functions are valid functions? Give me at least two function names. Meenakshi, are you there? Hello? Okay. Meenakshi, you're not there? Okay. Devdutt, can you answer? Can you name two functions you can use on string?
Sir, the F and F function is there, no, that one?
F is not a function. Actually, F strings are a type of strings. The functions which we have used are like say lower, upper, L strip, R strip,
Even
right?
this, the next line.
Yeah, title and all that stuff. Okay.
So
Great.
L strip and right strip.
Exactly. Yeah. Okay.
Sir, even upper.
Yeah, upper, lower, and all that stuff. Great. So now let's move on and let's see some of the functions, what you can use with the list data structure. So there are a lot of things you can use on the list. Say, let's try some few examples. Let's say I have cars array or cars list. Let's say I have Audi in it. I have BMW. I have Ferrari. And so on. And let's say I have one more last car. Let's say Suzuki. Okay. And let's add Honda as well. Okay. So I have a lot of cars here. Say if I have to print these cars. Okay. I can print just by saying cars. Okay. So it will just print these cars in whatever with the way how it is. Let's say if I change the order of this little bit. Okay, let's say I just changed this and for some reason I wanted to print the cars in a sorted, alphabetically sorted order. How do I do that? So there is a function called sort function. Let's say cars dot sort. Okay, this sorts the list. If you see now, the array is sorted on the alphabetical order. Audi, which starts with A, comes first, followed by the word which starts with B, F, H, and C. So this is a useful function which we can definitely use it at times. So similarly, there is a reverse function as well, which just reverses the list the way how it is positioned. So the BMW now goes to the last and Audi comes first and so on. So there are a few other functions as well where we can use some of the functions, like say for example, length function is used to find the length of the list. Say for example, how many elements are there? So you could use this, say for example, 5. In some cases, say for example, you could also use functions like min, max. Say for example, min would find the word which is the alphabetically lowest, which is Audi, and max, any guesses? Definitely it would be S, Suzuki, right? Because that word in the alphabetical order falls later, and that's how the max function picks it up. Similarly, say for example, now if you have a array of numbers, let's say there are array of numbers, okay, let's say there are array of numbers. So when you use function max function in array of numbers, it will find the maximum number. Similarly, when you use the min function, it would find the min value. Similarly, you can use the sort as well and reverse as well on the numeric arrays or number arrays. Okay, let's say I use numbers, okay, dot sort. Okay, you see the numbers are sorted now. Similarly, you could use reverse. The numbers in the array would be reversed. So just one thing to keep in mind, you cannot use the sort functions or reverse function, something like this. It won't print anything. See, it won't print anything because this just returns void or none. So that's why you'll not be able to use the function like this. Rather, you should be using the sort or reverse in a separate line and then print it like this. Okay. One of the different data types what we might come across other than sort is also called tuples or tuples. Okay, so there is a different pronunciations. People call it tuples or people call it tuples. So what is that one thing we have noticed here in list? You can change, you can add, remove, and all
sorry,
that
you're
stuff,
not
right?
I'm sorry to interrupt.
Oh, I'm not. Oh, okay, sorry, because you shared it, right? So yeah,
they're actually mutable and immutable.
Yeah. So basically, in lists, you can add, you can remove, and you can change. So in programming languages, we refer that to mutability or mutable data types, okay, or data structures. So any mutable data structure means you can change, you can remove, you can add, or you can edit. The immutable data types or data structures are, once you have created, you cannot change the values of it, or you cannot remove, or you cannot edit. So those are the immutable data structures. So in programming languages, there might be a need in certain scenarios where you need a list data type which is only readable, but you cannot change. Okay. So those kind of data structures are called as tuples or tuples. Okay. So the only difference between a list and a tuple here is the list. How did we define? We defined or we created by using a square bracket, right? You see, we have created the list or array using what?
Square bracket.
So the only difference with the tuples is we use normal brackets, okay?
Parentheses.
That's parenthesis. That's the only difference, right? So otherwise, everything else remains same. So here, if I just print, okay, student names, okay, this is a list data type. The moment I change this into normal parenthesis or normal, whatever you call it, parenthesis, this becomes a tuple. Okay. Now here, let's use the same things, right? It will print dev. I can use, say, 1 to 2, all those things, whatever the things, whatever we have seen, same things. You can use it here. The only difference is
we can't just append.
Yeah. The only difference is the way how you create. One, we have used the square bracket versus parenthesis. And let's try, let's see what happens. Okay. We have to learn this together. Let's see what happens. What does it say if I do append? Okay. Let's say Madan. Okay. Let's see what happens. Yeah, it should not. It should throw error because it is a tuple. The moment I change this to a normal list instead of a tuple, this works. You see the difference now? So this is a special type of a list, which we call it as tuples or tuples. Okay. The way the pronunciation, some people pronounce it as tuples, some people pronounce it as tuples. Okay. The only difference is the way how we create square bracket versus parenthesis. When you create a parenthesis list, it is called as tuples, and tuples are non-mutable, right? Let's try remove also. Okay, let's see what happens. Okay, similarly, it throws error. But when you do the same thing, okay, let's say Aditya, because Madan is not yet added. Okay, see, same error. But the same thing, if I use a square bracket, I am able to. Oops, what happened? Student names. Why? What is it showing? Has no attribute. Oh, spelling mistake. Okay. See, some of these things, if you don't pay attention, okay, we will end up with these kind of issues. Is it clear? The difference between a list and a tuples. Okay. Guys, are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, now, since we have seen some decent data structures, right? Now, let's learn about some control loops or control statements, okay? So, there is a control statement, what we call it as for loop, okay? Any guesses? What is a for loop? Maybe some of you would have heard of it.
Like the repetition?
Yes. Say, for example, if I wanted to repeat the same thing multiple times. So instead of saying, like, say, print one print two or whatever, right? Print two, print three. So if I have to repeat the same things multiple times, instead of repeating this multiple times, there is a smarter way of doing things, which is by using for control loop. Okay, let's see how we do this. Okay, so there are various syntax versions in the for loop. Okay, let's see the first version of it. Okay, so let's see the first version of it. Okay, so the for loop construct starts with for. Okay, now we give a name. Okay, let's say name. Okay, this is a new variable name. This new variable name we are referring into a list. So it all, the loops always take list or tuples. Okay, so list in names. Then I say, okay, print name. So what this does is now it prints all the names. How is it printing? So it is printing using a for loop. Now let's understand the syntax of for loop little bit. Okay, so the syntax of the for loop, okay, there are four parts in the first method. 1, 2, 3, 4. So the first is a keyword. So for is a programming language keyword. Okay, and here it is a new variable what we are declaring so that we can hold, we can have the value. Okay, so what happens here is when you are trying to use for loop, you are trying to hold the value, each of the value when it is iterating into a variable, otherwise you will not be able to use that variable. Okay, so we are holding a variable value, okay, whenever you are iterating onto lists. Okay, that is the second part. The third part is again a keyword or a reserved word in Python, which is in. So now you are saying, now you have to look the value of this variable in this list. Okay, the fourth part is you have to always provide a list, okay, or an array data structure. So now this will be a iterator which will go on to the student names and fetch every value and store it in the name. Then you can use or refer the value in the name. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Perfect. So there is another way, a slight change. What if I don't want to iterate? What do you understand by iterate? Iterate is nothing but going through the list. Okay, so we will be referring to this name iterate to iterate the list. Say if I don't want to iterate all the values, I can provide the indexing start and end. The way how I used to refer the index in the array, same thing. Say 1, 2, 3, right? Or I can use whatever the valid indexes start and end. So this will only iterate between 1 to 3. Okay, so that is one thing. Say for example, now I wanted to iterate everything. Okay, there is another way which we call it as using multiple functions. Okay, let's say name in, I wanted to iterate everything. Okay, so the other format is using two functions. There is a range function and there is a length function. Let's understand range first. Okay, let's say there is a range. Let's say 0 to 10. Okay, let's say number. Any guess what this will do? Devdutt, Neil.
It will print only from Devdutt, Neil, Aditya and Meenakshi, and that's it.
No, wrong. I have given, I'm not referring to student names at all here. This is just to print number between 0 to 10. Oh, I have
but
not provided
four.
No. This will print 0 to 9. You see? This is just to iterate 10 times. 0, because the indexes start from 0. This is to iterate 10 times. If I want to repeat same thing, like say, let's say, hello, Python, 10 times. This is how I do it. This is another variant of the for loop. One, we have taken a list. Second one, we are giving a range. Range also, the range is a function which returns a list. That's all. Is it clear? Say if you wanted to iterate 100 times, what do I do?
We have to type 100 there.
Yes. See, now this is printing 100 times. Say for example, I wanted to start with 1 and say print 100. It is all possible. Okay. So this is another variant. Now let's say the same thing what I did. Now I wanted to use range and length of student names. Okay, let's say n. Okay, let's print n. Let's see what happens here.
It'll print everyone one by one.
No, it is just only printing the indexes of it. Okay, 0, 1, 2, 3. That's all, because this is the same thing. This the range always prints the, say it takes the length of this whole thing and it will iterate 4 times. Length is nothing but 4, 0, 1, 2, 3, right? And it will iterate this many times. That's all. See the difference? Okay. Any confusions?
No, sir.
Okay. So there is another control. So we can use a while loop and also a for loop. So there are slight differences in while loop versus for loop. So for loop, we have seen a construct. While loop, there is a slightly different one. Okay. So how does a while loop work here? If you see, again, while loop has two parts. Okay. There is a keyword. Let's do this here, right, directly. Okay, there is a while, okay, and there is something, let's say number, okay, let's say number equals to 1, okay, let's say number is less than 10, okay, let's say I want to do something. What do I want to do? Let's say I wanted to print number. Okay, and let's say I wanted to increase the number value. By 1. Any guesses what would happen?
It will print from print.
It is printing numbers. It is repeating up to 9 times. You can use greater than, less than, whatever it is. Okay. Let's see. It is printing. It is repeating nothing but it is repeating this whole section which is written inside or with under the while control loop. Okay. So looping always has a syntax, right? Similarly, the way how we have seen for loop, while also has a syntax. So while is a keyword, space. Then a condition, you have to write a condition or an expression. So this is an expression. So expressions always have to evaluate to true or false. So when you write expressions like this, okay, expressions has two parts, left part, right part, and there is a operators. So basically, this will be evaluating and giving you only one outcome, whether it is true or false. Because number is 1, it will evaluate, well, 1 is always less than or equals to 10. So it becomes, this becomes true. So the loops will be executing as long as the expression evaluates to true. Okay, if this becomes true, only then it goes inside, or the statements, whatever is under the while loop, will be executed. Clear? Let's say, what happens now? Any guesses?
It will print only till 10 and then it will stop.
No, it will not print anything. Any guesses why?
Oh, sorry, sir, because the number is already greater than 10, so it won't print.
Exactly. So because the first time itself, the expression is false. The while loop only executes if the expression is. What should be the expression? It should be. Devdutt, what it should be? It should be always true. If the expression evaluates to true, only then the while block gets executed. Now, since 100 is not less than or equals to 10, this whole block will be ignored, or this block will not be executing. Let's say if this value is 9, what happens now? Any guesses? This will print two times, 9 and 10. Okay.
Sir, why two times? It should just add, no?
No, because number is starting with 9. Okay. 9 is less than or equals to 10. True or false?
It is less.
Okay. Then it prints. What it prints? It prints number. What is the value of the number?
9.
So it has printed. Okay, then it goes to the next line. It sees, okay, now I wanted to add 1 to number and then store it back in the number. What is the value of number now?
9 plus 1, 10.
Yes, now again it goes back to this condition. So again it checks. That's how the loops work. Again it checks. 10 is less than or equals to 10. True or false?
10 is equal to 10.
Yes. So then again it executes this block. Now what is the value of number variable? Ten. Right. That's how it has printed 10. And now it is increasing number 10 plus 1. How much?
11.
Now 11 is less than or equals to 10?
Greater than 10.
So it ignores that. Okay. Let's print number here one more time. Any guesses what it will print? It will be printing 9, 10, 11. Any guesses how?
Because
can someone explain?
Because when number is 9 in while loop, while it enters, the condition is true, it will print number 9. Then it will increment to 10. Then again, condition is true, it will print number, and then it will again increment to 11, and then it will print number. So it is 9, 10, 11.
How much ever we put this print number, that much time it will repeat?
Yes. Now, after this, it will not increase. If you keep on saying print, 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 it will print.
It will show only 11.
Only 11, because after that, you are not increasing the value of it, right?
Yes.
Clear?
Yes.
Okay. So this is another way of doing things. Okay. So you can write a lot of instructions inside the while block. Say, for example, you can increment, you can do certain things. Okay. Let's try this one more thing. Okay. Let's copy this and see what happens with this. Okay, let's do this simple thing. Okay. 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 So let's see. Any guesses what this will do?
So 1 minute, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Now let's try to trace this. So the current number is 0. Okay. Is 0 less than 10?
Yes.
Right?
It's
so
true.
The expression is true. Then it will execute this block under while. Okay. Now what are we doing here? You might see something new. Okay. This and this is equivalent. Okay, you can either do this or this, something like this. This is a shortcut version of increasing the value. Okay, this is a shortcut version. Okay, so this is the operator plus equals to. What it does is it increments the current number by 1. This is a shortcut expression. Okay, now the number has increased to 1. Now we are trying to find the remainder of the current number. When do we do this? Like this, to find even or odd numbers, right? We are saying if it is 0.
Yes, sir.
If it is 0, what?
If it is 0, it is 0. If it is, it is 0, then it's even number.
Yes, if it is not?
It's odd number.
Yes. So here we are trying to print what? Any guesses? Let's see what is happening. If you see, we are only printing odd numbers. Because there is something weird here. We are saying continue.
We have given continue.
Yeah. So what does this do? Okay. So when you see something like this, okay, if this condition matches, okay, this expression is true. This is also an expression. If this expression is true, we are saying ignore the next lines in the while block. Continue to the next iteration. That's why it is not printing the even number. If I remove this, it will print everything. All the numbers. See, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay. You see the difference? Okay. So now, since we have already introduced if condition, okay, so let's briefly learn about if conditions. So in programming, there might be always decisions like this, where you want to decide based on the outcome of this expression. Say if you wanted to express something, okay, let's say I wanted to check whether this number is even or not. Okay, what do I do? If it is 0, I print what? What if it is 0? Right? And I print the current number. Okay, if not, okay, let's say I print. Okay, it's not even, it is odd number. And I print current number. What's wrong? What is the syntax? Maybe there is a syntax error. Oh, it's correct only, right? Else colon. If, what does it say? Can only concatenate string, not int. Oh, sorry. My bad. I'm using Java syntax. That's the problem.
You should use this comma.
This does not work in. See, if you use so many programming languages, that's a difficulty to remember the syntax. Okay.
So instead of using F string, even we can use comma for concatenation.
Yeah, we can also use that because we have not introduced. I'll stick to the ones which we have introduced. Okay. So we have used F strings. Now This is how you use a if condition. So if you see, if again there is a syntax, okay, which we have to follow. If is a keyword space expression. If this expression evaluates to true, whatever is under this block gets executed. Okay, let's see this. Print. Okay. If got true. Okay. Similarly, you can put lot of instructions below else. If got false. Okay. See, if got false, then it is odd. If got true, it is even. All that things. So, if else has two parts. One, you can only have if without else. Okay, that is also possible. That is also valid. This is also valid program. Or you can have else block as well in the if. So if expression instructions, then optional else instructions. Is the syntax clear?
Yes.
Okay.
So how many numbers can we do this odd and even?
It's up to you. Up to you. If you say, I want to iterate this till 100, it will go up to 100. Your choice. However you want to write. See, it went up to 100. If you want to do only up to 50, you stop at 50. It will stop at 50.
So if you write right? some a number which is not known, will it work?
What do you mean by number not known?
Like we write one zero zero, make like many zeros. Will it work?
It will work to a certain extent. It will not work forever. It will stop working. You can write to a larger number, but you may not do that. See, it is working. It's still going on. Your program is still running. If you do like this. Okay.
So it continue.
Yeah, it will.
Okay.
Yep.
Sir, I have a class to attend from 5 o'clock. Could you send this recording in that, like you sending?
Sure, sure, sure. Thank you. I'll share the link. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. This is a very large one. Okay, we cancelled it. This is not good. We should not run like this. Okay.
Sir, how do you interrupt the execution?
Just Control C, the cancel one.
Okay.
Whatever normal ones. Yeah. Okay. So let's go to the next one. Okay. Let's also learn a little bit about the expressions. So expressions need not be always only in the if, else, or while blocks. You can use expressions anywhere. Let's say. Let's see this. Okay, let's have a string. Car equals to. Let's. What is your favorite car? Any guesses? What is your favorite car? Okay, let's.
I don't have any specific.
Okay, let's put BMW. Okay, now let's say I wanted to write an expression. How do I write an expression? Let's say car equals to Audi. What it will print? Any guesses? It will print false.
Because the car, first it said BMW, next you are saying Audi.
Yes. So what is this?
It's false.
No, this whole thing is called as an expression. Okay. So similarly, in expressions, we can use anything. Let's say number. Okay. Let's put a number. 10. Let's check this. Let's put number is equals to 10. What it will print?
10.
No. This is expression. It will print true because number is equals to 10, right?
Yes.
Okay. Now let's say number, what it will print? What it will print?
Number is equal to 10. It will say false.
Yes.
Because it should be equal to.
Yes. Okay. Let's say what it will print. False, right? So you can put any sort of expression like this. Okay. Okay, so there are few things. So you have seen expressions like say equals to, number equals to 10. Okay. There is another thing, another expression called not equals to. Any guesses what this will print? Let's keep it a little bit more simpler. Car not equals to Audi. What it will print? This will, the car value is BMW. Okay. It, this means not equals to. Okay. This is Audi. Car is not equals to Audi. Correct, right? True.
Sir, it will print true.
Yes. So it will print true. So similarly, you can use numbers also here. Say for example, number not equals to 1. What it will print? True. Say if you say number not equals to say 1, it prints true, then it should print false, right? So you can write expressions using double equals to or not equals to. Not equals to operator is used as exclamation and equals to characters, two characters together. Okay. Then there is a greater than which we have seen. Is number greater than 20? No, it is not. It should print false. Is number greater than 2? Then it should print 2. Similarly, there is something called less than also. This should print false. Is number greater less than 20? This should print true. So similarly, you also have less than equals to or greater than equals to. Okay, so there are few other operators. Similarly, less than equals to, greater than equals to. Now, we have only seen one expression, right? But you can also do two expressions. Okay, let's say number, okay, is greater than 1 and, okay, you can use and operators, okay? You can use and number is less than 100. What it will print? Any guesses?
True.
Yes, because number is between, number is greater than 1 and also the number is less than 100. What will happen if I do this? Any guesses? Only, see, number is, okay, this is printing, number is greater than 1, but this condition is failing. This will only print true if both of them are true, because the AND operator, okay, should evaluate both the expressions to be true. This will print false. Clear?
So even if one is correct, it will show it is false.
Yes, because AND means both of them have to satisfy.
Okay.
Okay. Perfect. Let's do the small trick. Any guesses what will happen now?
It will be true because it's OR.
Yes, either one of them, if it becomes true, it's okay. This will print true. True. Similarly, expressions can be used in the if block as well. See, if you see here, if block, I can do this same way. Okay. Here I can say true, okay, or I can say else print, okay, false. Okay, so now this has gone into this block. it is not printing false. Say if I similarly do change something, where it will go? It will always still go to true. And if I just change this and change this, where it will go? Any guesses? Any guess where it will go? You guys are there? It will go to false.
Because and
one of the condition is failing. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Perfect. So we have seen how to do and or you can keep continuing and you can club the operators, right? You can just keep on clubbing the operators like this. Or number is greater than 2, or and number is less than 1, all those kind of things, you can keep on doing it. Okay, certainly if you want to give group certain things, you can use parentheses. Okay, so you can keep on writing any number of expressions or expressions in the if loop or in while loop or in the print or wherever you want to do. Okay, now let's also see, there is one more variant of expressions. Let's say student names. Okay, let's say Neil. Okay, let's say Aditya. Okay, now let's say I wanted to check. Okay, print. Okay, let's take another small syntax. I wanted to check if a certain name, okay, Dave, in student names. Any guesses what it will print? It is printing true because this name, this is also a form of expression. Okay, so this will print true. Let's say if I try to find my name. Any guesses what it will print? It will print false because my name is not in this list. Okay, so this is another way of using expressions. Okay, now let's also use directly the Boolean variable. Okay, let's say I'm Boolean variable. How do you assign Boolean values just like this? Okay, see, true. If you want to change the value of this Boolean.
Sir.
Mm-hmm.
Sir, I have to give a test. Can I leave now?
Yeah, sure. You can watch the video later, okay?
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay, yeah, thank you. Bye. That is another way of writing expressions. Okay, so now let's move on to the next topic and see how do we use if-else condition and chain them. So in some cases, you may require to use more than one if and else block. So you can chain the multiple if statements and try to use them in particular scenarios like this. Say for example, let's take a situation and an example. Let's say we define a car and assign a value BMW. Let's say if we wanted to check and do certain operation if the car is BMW. Okay, let's say we're gonna print I am a BMW car, else if. So else if is written as ELIF, short form, car equals to Audi. Print I am an Audi, else print it's an unknown car. Let's see what happens. See, it is printing BMW. Let's say if I change this to Audi, they should print I am an Audi car. So if you see, there are multiple if else statements which you can chain like this. You can add any number of statements like this. Let's say I wanted to add Ferrari as well. I am Ferrari, like this. So you can add any number of if else statements by chaining them like this together. Okay, so this is one thing, and we can mix a lot of statements. Say for example, we can use for, say for example, number in range, and then say 1 to 100, and then inside that you can mix if number. Okay, say for example, so we have used this, right? So number ampersand or percentage, okay, 2 equals to 0. You can use something like this, okay, even, and so on. Oops. We have missed one more thing here. So all those things are possible. So you can mix if for everything in between. Okay. We'll come back to these things wherever there was error. I'll try to fix it and I'll come back to you guys. Okay. Okay. So should we move on to the next topic? Someone was asking for the dictionaries, right? So basically, a dictionary is nothing but it's a another data type or another data structure. Whatever we have seen so far, they are all either primitive types like strings, integers, floats, list sort of thing. Okay. Now we also saw tuples, right? So now we are trying to create a little bit more complex data type, because in programs you may need more than strings, integers, if you wanted to work with a little bit more complex objects or complex data as such. So a dictionary is very specific to Python, which is kind of a key value data structure, okay, or a key value data type, okay. So what does that mean? It might just sound like a very, very confusing thing, right? How many of you have seen dictionaries? How many of you seen dictionaries? Dave, have you seen dictionary?
No.
No?
No, I've not seen.
You have not seen a dictionary? So have you seen Oxford Dictionary?
In the internet while buying and all, I saw.
You don't have a dictionary at home?
No, I'll Google for me.
Okay. So, you have textbooks, right? School textbooks?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes,
have you ever noticed there is a index table either at the beginning of the book or at the end of the book? Have you ever seen a textbook?
In the beginning, it is there of the chapter.
In the end also, there will be some textbooks, they print indexes at the end of the textbook. Have you noticed? Saying that, hey, this word is there in this page, sort of thing.
Like in storybooks, like of Kindle, some storybooks will be there. In that thing, it will be then the last many words mean.
Yeah, exactly. So most of the books print indexes at the end, okay? Or some books might just not print it, okay? So the whole purpose of this index, any guesses what is the purpose of these indexes? To find which word is located in which page. You cannot just search the whole book, right? Say for example, if you are looking for one particular word in the book, you cannot just read all the 200 pages of the book and try to see, okay, where that particular word is in that textbook, right? So it's useful if you have an index where it says you can find this word in this page, okay? A simplified version is also a table of content. Say for example, at the beginning of the chapter or beginning of the book, you would see lot of chapters, topics or subsections with page numbers mentioned on it, right? So what is the use of it? Primarily, we use them to refer which topic or which chapter belongs to which page or where you can find in which page. Otherwise, it will be very difficult for you to find the topic in the textbooks, right? So the dictionaries, similarly, if you have large collection of data, say for example, if you have say how many students are there in your school there? Maybe 500, right?
In my school, I don't know. In class, there are 20.
Let's make a guess. Maybe 500,000.
Okay.
There will be 1,000 people. Say if you want to store all the 1,000 students' marks, how will you store? You can use list, right? You can create a list and you can add all the student marks into the list. But how do you know which marks belong to which student? How does list, you can
use the command prompt.
Yeah, so basically you can use dictionaries which will store with a name. Say for example, it's like say for example, again, it's like your mom putting stickers on top of each of the box. Say if every container in the kitchen is similar, every box is similar, how do you know in which box sugar is there, in which box salt is there? If every box is of same size and same color, same shape, everything is same, if you have 20 boxes, what will you do? How would you find? It's difficult, right? Either you have to open each and every box to see in which box what is there. If you want to find sugar, if the box is closed, steel box, all boxes are of same size, it's very difficult, right? What if your mom writes a label and sticks it on top of the box saying that this is sugar, this is salt, this is turmeric, this is chili, this is something else and spices and all that stuff. Is it then easy to find out which ingredient is in which container? Right? Is it easier or not? You guys are there still? It is, right? So dictionaries are a similar concept. When you have large collection of data, if you want to know which value belongs to which entity or which person or which variable, then we can use a concept called dictionaries. Okay. So for today, let's stop here because a lot of folks have gone for different things. Let's continue. Let's stop here and see if you have any questions. Dave?
Hiya.
Yep.
Like a list, a dictionary is a thing, like many lists also is a dictionary, no?
Yes. The list, the only difference is in the list, you have to iterate each and everything to find. Dictionaries are slightly better because they have labels. saying that this book belongs to Dave, this book belongs to Madan, so that it's easy to find when you have all the books placed in, like say, one rack.
On the syntax and all, is there, no, like the if comment, this quotes and all, should it be, can it be in capital letters?
Capital letters, which one? The syntax, no, it's all case sensitive. So the keywords and all, we have to be very careful while we use capitals versus the same thing. Whatever the keywords I have mentioned, it has to be the same way.
And is there a command to do the toggle case?
Toggle case for what?
Like the text and all. Is there a way to do that?
For toggling the text?
Yes.
What do you mean by toggling the text?
Like just inverting. If it is in the capitalized thing, uppercase, we can change it to the lowercase, and which all are in the lowercase, we can change it to uppercase.
That we have seen, no? Lower and upper.
Yeah, but in one code, everything gets inverted like that.
There should be, actually. I think we can try. Let's try. Let's see. Let's print. If there is a function, it will print. Otherwise, it won't. Let's see. Car dot lower or upper, right? So we have tried this. First, let's see if it works. It works. Let's say toggle. Let's see if there is a function. No, there is no toggle function. Oh. Maybe we have to write. There is no function toggle.
Okay.
Okay. What else?
That's it.
Okay. Then let's stop here. And then we can continue tomorrow. Okay, tomorrow we can spend a little bit more time. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Hello. Have fun.
Thank you, sir.
Bye.